Oh, wait, hold on. I got a Slack, guys. Let me check who it is. Nothing. Nothing important. Shocker. All right, here we go. What's up, everybody? Welcome to... I just wanted to freak Jada out. She's just looking off screen. We'll start over for real this time. All right, here we go. What's up, everybody? Welcome to this week's episode of Podcast Beyond. I'm your host, Mark Medina, and I'm joined, as always, I don't get a choice in the matter, by Jada Griffin.
He really doesn't. I recently got my doctorate, according to a text message I got. And Mark, there is no cure for what you have. So
that's unfair.
It's okay. It's something you can live with. It's manageable. You'll still live a long, healthy life. But what you have, it just can't be cured.
Why do you gotta really bum me out right before the episode?
Hey, you know what?
Healthy life? Come on. Could this day get any worse? Anyways, Matt Kim's also here.
I'm not a doctor. You're gonna live forever.
What a day. What a day filled with just news that's, you know. I like your coffee though. I need everyone to know that this show is late because Matt was getting coffee. And that's the
making
only
reason
coffee.
Why. I need people to know that I make my own coffee. Roast the beans myself.
He grows the beans, even to take it further. He grows the beans in a like on his patio. He's got like one of those little just terrariums. I don't know what's it called when you. It's not a terrarium. It's the wrong word. But
nobody knows.
You know what I mean.
There's actually no way to know.
You know,
the squirrel drops them off. Just packs of beans.
So many questions. And then we're also joined by Natalie Flores. Of X Fanbyte fame.
Yes, X Fanbyte fame. Hello, everyone. Hi.
So just like last week, we had Kenneth Shepherd on. Kenneth was an awesome guest. We also have Natalie on this week, who's here to kind of just, you know, let people know what she's been up to, who she is, where to follow her. So Natalie, I'm going to kind of let you have the floor. You can kind of explain everything that happened without going into an insane amount of detail, because I don't think you want that. But yeah, why don't you tell everybody who you are and where they can follow you?
Yeah, so I am Natalie. I used to be the assistant managing editor over at Fanbyte before I got unceremoniously laid off almost a week and a half ago. I can't actually talk about the layoffs very much. Due to legal reasons. But what I can say is that I think we were building something really special, and it's unfortunate that it won't reach the potential that it had from the beginning, and that I'm super lucky to have amazing colleagues and friends and the coworkers that I worked with. Ken is one of my closest friends. I've been like a recurring guest on his Patreon show, Normandy FM, several times. So I have nothing but love for everyone that I worked with. I was just telling Mark before the show that we're doing this thing where we're going through our LinkedIn profiles and recommending each other and saying really cheesy things about how wonderful it was to work with each other for future employers. So yeah, I think that speaks to sort of the bond and the environment that we had over there. And so, yeah, I'm free on the market. Doesn't sound like a very good way of saying it, but I am looking for work. So you can follow me over at Hartimecia. That's Hartimecia on Twitter. It's a Final Fantasy VIII reference because it's a good game. And I am looking for video game consulting work, game editing, game writing, PR and marketing, anything that involves words and storytelling. I am game. Yeah.
Nice. Well,
Mark,
if
me or you ever leave IGN, I expect the cheesiest and the worst written LinkedIn message to recommend me.
You'll make it where I never find a job ever again.
You'll live a long, healthy life forever. Apparently.
Great.
So I'm not a doctor. I'm just saying. But I am a psychic.
Well, Natalie, it's great to have you.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah. And sorry. But it's good to have you. And it was good to have Kenneth. And I think we're gonna have a fun episode ahead of us. There's a lot of cool stuff to go over this week. We got our E3 dates. which is exciting. The first HBO trailer for The Last of Us dropped, which is good. But the biggest news ever happened that couldn't be more relevant to Podcast Beyond, which is Vince Gilligan, creator of Breaking Bad and Better Call Saul, has a new show on Apple TV Plus. We don't know the name of the show, but we do know that it stars Kim Wexler from Better Call Saul. This is the biggest news ever. This is as the official Apple TV podcast of IGN.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm. And yep, that's us.
I forgot that's a running bit of ours.
I haven't watched season 6 yet, so I'm just going to take a stab in the dark. It's called Kim's Revenge. That's what the show's going to be called. It's just going to be a continuation.
For the sake of clarity, she's not playing Kim Wexler.
She's not Kim Wexler. She's not. Sorry, that was my bad. Yeah. What's it? Because the actress's name is Rhea Seehorn, right? Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. So I just had a moment where I forgot her name, and so I was just like, "It's Kim Wexler." But yeah, it's not Kim. It's not a Kim Wexler show.
No, it's not.
It's just starring her, and I guess it kind of is like more in the vein of like the Twilight Zone.
Yeah,
versus like
X Files-y Twilight Zone-y. Yeah. And also, Vince Gilligan was like, I'm done writing anti-heroes. I want to write a regular hero. So whoever Rhea Seehorn, Kim Wexler is going to play is going to be not as morally ambiguous as like Saul and Walter White.
Mm-hmm.
But we're really taking this Apple TV show thing far.
I finished Better Call Saul, like a month ago. And I instantly jumped into Breaking Bad. Breaking Bad is a better paced show than Better Call Saul. Better Call Saul has a lot of episodes where I'm just like, what was the point of that episode? But Walter White is the worst. I don't know how anybody like likes that character. He is the worst. He is awful. I can't wait for every comment to tell me that that's incorrect.
No, you watch the show to root against Walt. Like, that's just the kind of the thing. You want to see him. You want to see him struggle. You want to see him fail, but he somehow always comes out on top, which doesn't, you know.
It's like Saul Goodman at least had some redeeming qualities, mm-hmm. where Walter White, he has none. Natalie, what's your take on Breaking Bad? Uh-oh, I think we lost her. I was like, she's sitting so incredibly still. Okay, she told me that this might happen. It is raining where she is.
Mm.
So, yesterday was The Last of Us Day. And a lot of people thought that we would get a Last of Us 2 PlayStation 5 version, right? And what I mean by that is an actual, like, director's cut, like an actual legit version of the game. Because the game has been updated for PS5, but basically it got the God of War, Days Gone, Horizon Zero Dawn treatment, right? Where it just has an improved frame rate. But if you look on the dashboard, it still says it's the PS4 version of the game. So it still has like the slower load times and stuff like that. We did not get a PS5 version of the game, but it kind of made me think about some other games I've been going back to and playing. And I've been kind of wishing that we would get more PS5 versions, whether they be updates or actual full versions of the game. And so I kind of wanted to go around the list and kind of see what games you guys kind of had in mind. Jada, we'll start with you.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, we kind of talked about and made a list of other ones. You guys kind of stole some of the ones I had ideas for, so yep. I'm going to go a little bit out of the wheelhouse. Last Guardian is a good one for the PS5 treatment. You know, it's, you know, just like Shadow of the Colossus and Ico got the PS4 treatment. I'd love to see Last Guardian get the PS5 treatment since it was a PS4 game originally, if I remember correctly. It's been so long since I played that game, but it was gorgeous. I think it could do really cool things with the PS5 enhancements. Other than that, the Infamous Second Son. We haven't seen Infamous pop off like it did during the PS3 era. I think even when it dropped on PS4, it wasn't as popular as they were expecting it to be.
Mm-hmm.
And so I would love to see Infamous Second Son get it, because there's just so many like really cool effects and like the open world and just being able to like really beef up the explosions, the damage, the destruction in the game, especially when you're playing the Infamous route.
Now, it'd be really cool. Correct me if I'm wrong, but Infamous, was it one of the games that did get that kind of like unceremonious PS5 update, or is it just like, yo, whatever the version, the performance mode that got put on PS4 Pro, it just runs insanely well now. I can't remember if it actually got like any sort of like PS5 patch.
I don't think it got any type of PS5 patch. I could be wrong on this though. I just know this is one I haven't played in a while, and getting a kind of a more ceremonious patch would be encouraging for me to want to go back and re-dive into this world, because it is a lot of fun. It's a great world, and I would just like to, I want more Infamous games. It's basically what I'm pitching right now, because I know everybody at the development studio, which is Sucker Punch, right, for this one?
That's them.
Yeah, is they're listening right now to the podcast, so I'm talking directly to them.
And they're also working on Ghost of Tsushima 2.
Yep. So. Yep. And then do you want to
blow through all yours, or do you want?
Yeah, might as well.
Okay,
let's blow through all mine, and then you know you guys can stop listening to me, because you know I know the audience loves not hearing me, along with Mark. And then if you know looking through even further back lens, a couple PS3 exclusives I'd love to see get just the treatment. Resistance is a big one that comes to mind. Sony needs an FPS right now, to kind of start building up and taking that space where Call of Duty may be vacating. So I think Resistance would be a great candidate for that. Give us a 1-3 trilogy remaster, just kind of like they've done with Ratchet and Clank and Sly Cooper. Like, let's give us that collection of those great games, and prep us for Resistance 4. And then another one, it's a bit of a gem, but Heavenly Sword. I freaking loved Heavenly Sword back in the PS3. It was kind of like the, hey, it's kind of God of War action-ish and very over the top, like kind of came out right during that era when those types of games were really taking a foothold in the market. And I feel like it just didn't get the support it needed. I think it might have had a little bit of the like six-axis type controls, like stuff for special things in there. So that may be one of the challenges. But it's been a while since I've played that one as well. But I would love to go back and revisit Heavenly Sword as well.
Do we have Natalie back? Is she back?
She is back! Yes, hooray!
Sorry for that. It stopped storming outside and nothing happened while it was raining, but suddenly it stopped storming and it just ran. So.
All of a sudden you were just like really frozen on our video. And I was like, oh, God, she is just, she is listening intently.
And now the clouds have parted, the rain has stopped, and Natalie has come as the sunshine.
We are at the section of the podcast, thank you for joining us, where we are talking about PS4 games that we want to get a PS5 patch or a full re-release. Jada just listed all of her games. Matt, we'll kick it on over to you because me and you have an overlapping game, so I'm going to let you have this one.
Yeah, my list is shorter, and also you made the mistake of letting me go ahead of you, so I'm just going to steal the one that we have together, Bloodborne.
An obvious
would
hit.
Be Aces. It'd be Aces. Give me Bloodborne with 60 FPS and, I don't know, like, up-res it or something, make it cool again. But it looks great. I play it now. Like, I play it, like, every year. I replay Bloodborne once a year. And if I can get a version of it that looks a little better, that plays a little better on PlayStation, like, sign me right up. I want to play it so bad.
Yeah, Bloodborne is one of those games that it's just trapped on PS4. It's got long load times. The frame rate is... It's not even that the frame rate's, like, bad. It's just the fact that it's all over the place, right? Like, it just...
Yeah.
It dips so low and then will kind of, like, pop back up. And so, I definitely see that as one of the biggest contenders.
I think if you download it onto a PS5, it solves the load time stuff. I think it loads pretty fast on a PS5. I'm gonna have to double check or whatever. But I don't time these things. Not like you do for work, but I think the load time stuff gets fixed. But everything else could. I mean, like I said, there's nothing wrong with Bloodborne now, and it's certainly aged, like, really, really well.
Yeah.
It could just, you know, it could use a little sprucing up, and I would absolutely love to play it.
I think Lies of P is just the PS5 patch for Bloodborne.
Yeah. I haven't played it yet. I want to. What else is there? Oh, right, and I also have Gravity Rush on my list, because that was a PlayStation Vita release, and then it got a PlayStation 4 remaster. And then I, you know what? Let's just go all the way. Let's just bring it back to PS5.
Yeah, yeah. I agree. I love Gravity Rush too. That was a very early on IGN, you know, Mark Medina day. And I had never played the first one, and I got assigned Gravity Rush 2. And I was like, man, this game is like really good, actually. But I haven't played it in a long time. So I definitely agree that it could use some sprucing up.
It was one of those things where I got it on sale digitally for like $15 because I think at the time the physical PS4 copies of Gravity Rush Remastered became like crazy expensive for some reason.
Oh, weird.
Yeah, and then I think I saw it at a GameStop once. So I just picked it up for like $20. So now I have it like digital and physical. But I love those games.
Yeah. Okay. Natalie, are you with us?
Yes, I am. Oh, nice. I am not frozen right now.
Okay. Well, we'll kick it over to you. What are some games that you'd like to see get brought over to the PS5?
So immediately I thought Dragon Age Inquisition. I really love that game, and it is very much in need of the PlayStation 5 treatment. I mean, we have Dragon Age Dreadwolf, which probably won't be out for a really good while, but it feels like a given for them to, you know, move over Dragon Age Inquisition to the PlayStation 5, especially since we will be talking about this probably at some point, but just having a upcoming Netflix show, Dragon Age, like, it feels like a good opportunity to get people, you know, coming to return to a game. So it feels like an opportunity that shouldn't be missed for them to, you know, put Dragon Age Inquisition on the PlayStation 5 and let me see my ugly bald elf. I mean, bald ugly elf egg husband in all the frame rate glory that he deserves.
Dragon Age Inquisition is the only Dragon Age game I've ever played. And I completely agree because I played it and I was playing it on PS4. And I think I got to that first, like, the like first like fight that you do. This is before like the hinterlands, before you even get to like your like first town or whatever. And the frame rate dropped and I was like, I can't do this. And I switched to the PC version and I liked the game a lot. But I agree. I would love to see like a console version of that game get improved.
Yeah, it's a little rough on console. Even like going back to it, it had a few frame rate issues and it felt like it stuttered a lot. So it really needs a treatment, in my opinion. And it's a good game. Like it's great, actually. I really love it. It's my favorite Dragon Age. So I would love to see it come back on the PlayStation 5.
All right. And then you have another game on your list here.
Yes, Nier Automata, which I think is just an incredible game that deserves, the head nods, it just deserves to be on every platform, optimized to its full potential. I want to see 2B in the wonderful frame rate, like the highest frame rate that you can give me, the best quality that you can give me, one of my favorite games of all time. And it's coming out for the Switch very soon, so it doesn't feel like the most graphically optimal release that's possible for it right now. So I'd love to see it on the PlayStation 5.
I freaking love this Nier.
Yes.
It was my game of the year for 2017. You know, Breath of the Wild, Horizon, both excellent games that year. But Nier, it hit me so much deeper. Just emotionally, the gameplay was awesome. The story was great. There was so much extra content. The soundtrack, I bought the vinyl. I listened to the vinyl probably every once a month at minimum. And it's on my Spotify list regularly to where I listen to once a week. But it's just so good. If you got anybody out there who has not played Nier Automata, or just go play it. Do yourself a service. Go play this game. It is so good. I still haven't gotten around to playing Nier Replicant yet, which is feels like a sin for me. But it is on the backlog list and it is moving up quickly. So I'm very excited to see how that one kind of handled the remake from the PS3 version that it originally was. So
I like that on the review B-roll they have going on. One of the chapter breaks was to be or not to be. And that's just that's brilliant.
Just a good one.
It's absolutely brilliant. Whoever reviewed this game, great job. Okay, so my games on the list, one is I feel like kind of an obvious. I had Bloodborne on the list, but I was like, I'll give it to Matt. It's such a you know, obvious one that I was like, somebody else can have this if somebody else writes it. I wrote Red Dead Redemption 2 mainly because, you know, that game's awesome and the PC version does exist. It's a bit demanding on PC, of course, but jumping into that game on your Series X or your PS5, it, you know, you instantly get hit with that 30 frames per second and the slower load times, and you're like, why, right? And we just got Grand Theft Auto 5. It's PS5 Series X version, and so while I would love Red Dead to get the treatment, I don't know if Rockstar is going to do it. Mainly, it's like, just unlock the frame rate, but that just doesn't seem like a Rockstar thing to do. It seems like that they would, just like GTA 5, it seems like they would want to sell the game again, and unlocking the frame rate doesn't allow them to do that. So it's just kind of a bummer, but, you know, I would love to be able to play that game.
Mark, don't ask Rockstar for anything else right now. No. Like, you know the GTA fans in the audience are yelling at you right now. They're like, no, do not distract them with anything other than GTA 6.
Just go into the code and it's like, turn off VSync. I know it's that easy. I am a game developer. No, I don't know anything. But yeah, I would like that. And then my other one is Fallout 76, which I said in the last episode is just a real bad game, but I still play it all the time. And I said this last week, and, you know, what are you gonna do? But I'm playing it on Series X now because Series X has the FPS boost, which is kind of I don't think artificial is the right term, but it's a system side boost to the frame rate that allows the game to run at a higher frame rate than the game's actually built to run at, except for on PC. And so that's like a system side update, but it's not an actual game update. So the PS5 version of Fallout 76 is absolutely the worst version of the game to play. And so the game needs a patch, is all I'm going to say. For a live service game that they just put an update out for and that they continue to, you know, their intent is to keep pushing out updates for this game, it's like, it just surprises me that they're fine with having it run in the state that it runs in, which is like really long loading and like 30 frames per second, when something like The Division 2 got an update very early on in the PS5 lifecycle. So yeah, it's just a surprising kind of deal. So yeah, those are our games that we want to get PS5 updates, whether they be just patch updates or actual versions. So make sure to let us know in the comments what games you would like to see, because I'm sure there is a long list of them. We're going to switch gears to The Last of Us HBO show. Has everybody here watched the trailer?
Yes.
No.
No.
I'm just kidding. You're joking. Yes.
I'm like, you're joking. Of course I've seen it. It was a minute long.
I'm on the social team. I have to like keep up to date on everything new as it drops to make sure that I'm on top of things.
Jada's a doctor. Like, maybe she didn't have a minute to watch it.
It dropped while she was in the middle of a surgery. She was
busy getting her prognosis.
I was reviewing the numbers, and it just, like, I had it playing in the background, but I really didn't get to pay attention to it. Like, so, like, I could say that I watched it, but...
You watched it through an x-ray.
Yeah, you know. It was in another room through a window off of a mirror because like the lab techs were watching it and not paying attention to what they were supposed to be doing. Like, but I got to see it, I guess.
Scalpel. Like, hold on, it's Joel. He looks like Oberyn now from Game of Thrones. We have to figure out what's happening. So we got like a 4 or 5 second glimpse of what that show looks like in like an HBO teaser like a month ago. And then we've seen some like set photos and stuff like that. But this was the first time. This is still technically a teaser. You know, it was just laid over top a song and a song that's also in the game. And, you know, you don't really get much story details. A lot, you know, Last of Us fans know what's happening, right? Yeah. But if you're not familiar with this franchise at all, you just saw a collection of scenes that probably don't mean much to you. So it's more of a like, hey, this is what we're working on, this is what the show is going to look like, and less of a like, here's what the show is actually about. But that's what we're here for. We're going to break it down scene by scene. We're definitely not going to do that.
We did that yesterday.
Yeah, but Matt, I want to start with you. What did you think of the trailer?
I thought it was a good looking trailer. I thought the scene that most shot out, that most stood out to me weirdly, was not seeing Joel or Ellie in person or the clicker even, but it was that shot of that stormy area towards the beginning of the game with the buildings collapsed on one another, right? Yeah. And maybe it was because like I literally just played that episode level in the game like a couple weeks ago, but like I was like, that is just they're doing it, they're making the game into a show, and that is the thing that was like the one-to-one of it all was very cool for me, I think.
Honestly, like, I love The Witcher, right, for what it is and stuff like that, but it's like, this seems like one of the most, like, faithful adaptations. Like, a lot of these scenes are ripped right from the game. Mm-hmm. Natalie, what about you? You're a Last of Us fan, right?
Yeah, so I have a complicated relationship with Last of Us. Last of Us Part 2, in that shelf where you put the special games that have impacted you, changed your life, etc., made you ascend to another plane of existence. The Last of Us 1, I'm not actually a huge fan of. So I was a bit skeptical leading up to this. I was definitely in the crowd of people who are like, oh, well, the game itself kind of looks like a movie. Like, what are they going to do? But seeing this trailer, I really liked what I saw. I think Pedro Pascal is just perfect as Joel. I think Bella Ramsey doesn't have the immediate like visual pull that he has in terms of like his resemblance to Joel, but I'm really excited to see how she does the role. I really love the little snippet where you show her looking at Riley with a lot of love and care, so I'm very excited to see how they pull that off. In terms of like my enjoyment or what I'll get out of this, to me, if this means that, because there's a scene in the trailer where it's very clear that they're going to probably encompass the whole game. I mean, there was a scene that has like the winter section of the game showing. So to me, if they're going to cover the entire game in one season and the next season is Last of Us Part 2, like, I'm so down for that. I'm so down to see how they realize that game in a movie, or not in a movie, in like a show. I think it's going to bring a lot of new people to the show, actually, to the game maybe. Just because like, in terms of how it functions, even though I was thinking, well, the game kind of functions like a movie, it's like really, you know, film geared cutscenes with some gameplay in between, that's still a barrier to a lot of people who would rather not, you know, play a game or think about the term video game, and they sort of write it off as not being for them. This will have no barriers to anyone who really wants to get into this story and really follow it. So I think that'll be great on that hand. And for established fans, they'll be able to see what this sort of, this iteration of The Last of Us is with the blessing of Neil Druckmann behind it. So, yeah.
Jada, what about you? I just to respond to Natalie really quick. I thought it was a little strange as well, where it's like, you know, you see scenes from Outbreak Day, and then you see, you know, I don't want to spoil the show for people that like maybe haven't played the game, but like there's definitely some ending shots there. But Jada, what's your take on this whole thing?
Yeah, no, I love the trailer. I think it's great, or teaser, whatever we want to call it. I think it's excellent. There's so many shot for shots that we're seeing in this teaser that we are pulled straight from the game. There's also moments that are kind of done differently and made bigger, which I really respect. There's the whole during Outbreak Day, we see the plane crash into the gas station. That's not what happens in the game. It's just a car that runs into the gas station and causes that big explosion. Unless I missed a plane crashing somehow in my like 12 playthroughs of the dang game, but I'm sure some planes crashed. But yeah, I think it's really great. I'm really excited to see what Bella Ramsey does as Ellie. I'm very excited to see how they pull off the different like deeper moments and such that we get from the emotional moments you get from the games. I'm really excited we're getting Left Behind content in it. I honestly was not expecting to see left behind content in this first season of the show. And I'm very excited that they're doing that. We're going to get to see Riley. We're going to get to see Ellie before, well, not before Outbreak Day, but before she meets Joel, and just kind of like the elements that kind of build her up into who she, part of what makes her who she is before her transformation with Joel and such. So I'm really excited.
If I had to guess, the left behind stuff is a flashback, mainly because
that would be my guess too.
Like, are they really going to retread that kind of stuff? You would think, you know, the most powerful ending for The Last of Us is that opening, right? And so it's like, but technically in a show, you would want to cover the left behind stuff maybe first. I don't know. So it's a little, you know, to kind of introduce Ellie. Just the way it was shot, it's like that really like close up of Riley. I'm like, this seems kind of like she's telling a story type of
thing. Yeah, the bloom and the lighting and everything on her. Yeah, definitely could see it being a flashback, 100%. But I don't know. We'll see. We'll see how deep of a flashback it is. Maybe it's a dream sequence to where it's a flashback in a dream and it actually is like happening type stuff. Who knows? We'll see what it ends up being.
It could also be like just an episode of the show, right? So when you're looking at, you know, if it, like maybe it's 10 seasons, maybe episode 7, something, you know, that suddenly becomes pertinent and you get this entire, it would still technically be a flashback, but it's still, it's this entire like kind episode. Of prequel that takes you away. Maybe Joel's not even in that episode kind of deal. So yeah, with all video games,
I was thinking it might be an episode in and of itself. Mm-hmm. And I wonder if that would be better or if it would be, and I think it would take a specific caliber of filmmaker to pull this off, but to intersperse like those flashbacks across different episodes as like things that Ellie is remembering as she goes on this journey with Joel. I wonder which one would be the route that they're taking and which one I would like more. Both seem attractive.
Yeah.
Potential. Yeah. It's scenarios.
It's like, I'm trusting them to tell me what I want. But yeah, I hadn't thought too much until you brought it up, Natalie, that it's like this first season technically would be the whole first game, right? And so technically The Last of Us Part 2 is a bit longer, so like maybe that's like 2 or 3 seasons, because like that game is like more than double the length of the first game.
Or what if we got a season per like the dual protagonists that we have in that game, just to like dance around the issue. Maybe we get a season for each one or something like that. I mentioned Dragon Age and the fact that it's getting a Netflix show earlier because I think that pipeline of create a good show then will, you know, attract people to go back to those games. I think BioWare needs to do what Naughty Dog has done here, which is they made sure that part one was ready, the optimized way to experience the story that we're going to see in the show. And that's ready for when the show actually airs in 2023. So that people who really like that are able to say, oh, I'm going to check the game out. I don't normally play games, but I like The Last of Us, so I'm going to do it. And they're going to go back to the game. So I think that would be a really cool scenario, actually, if they did a season for both protagonists in part two.
Yeah, I mean, and we're seeing that kind of resurgence even with games that aren't getting that fully optimized, perfected version with, you know, Cyberpunk Edgerunners. So you're talking about it earlier. You know, Cyberpunk has seen its highest player counts since launch. I think it's higher its peak, right? And it's overpeaked like Witcher 3 at this point too.
Yes.
Like it's crazy that these shows are doing the job of bringing players back into the worlds, and it's great. I love it. I love the content that's going into these shows, and I'm all for it. So
I think what's going to be interesting, and who knows what the deal is, and like they do have Neil Druckmann on board to kind of help shepherd the show. Like he's not like the showrunner, but he is, you know, one of the producers on it. And so it's like I wonder, I don't think that this would happen, but I'm wondering if we're eventually going to get some sort of Game of Thrones scenario where HBO has ordered an X amount of series, seasons, and they eventually get beyond what the games have gotten to, because it's like games are, you know, they take so long to make. So theoretically, I guess we live in a world where Naughty Dog could finish up Factions and then start, if they haven't already, on Last of Us Part 3, which you know, we're not even entirely sure if that's actually going to happen. Last of Us Part 2 had such a like definitive ending, but so did Last of Us Part 1. And so, like, are they going to start work on Last of Us Part 3 that maybe by the time they're aiming for that launch, maybe we'll be on season 3 or 4 of The Last of Us, and then they'll be able to kind of adapt that? Or are they eventually going to get ahead of the show and it starts becoming a more original story?
Seems like the future is bright for The Last of Us, and that it's not going anywhere for some time to come. Which, mm-hmm. if that means it's easier to get a part 3, I would love to see that for so many reasons that I guess I'll not talk about on here in case of spoilers for
I know it's always this weird thing to like balance, because I'm like, hey, I know how the first season ends, and like so does a lot of people, but there are a lot of people that don't know. So let's switch gears to something that is a little weird. It's something that we've known about for a while, and that E3 2023 is coming back. It is going to be a thing after a little bit of a break. And yesterday we got the news. I think it was yesterday or the day before. I can't remember. I think it was
yesterday.
What is time? we got the dates for E3 and how they're going to kind of split it up. So the return dates are June 13th through the 16th, with separate days for what they're calling E3 business days and E3 gamer days. And then the other thing that's worth noting is that they have their partner digital events, which will precede the physical expo, and that'll begin June 11th, which is typical for E3, right? E3 doesn't technically start until like the Tuesday of that week, but most people see it as like the Saturday, because you know that's when all the presentations and stuff were happening. Matt, what do you think about E3 returning?
Okay, yes, I'm excited for E3 to return. E3 has always been a great event for industry folks and for fans, and it's a good time. And I think the whole like, oh, we never needed an E3 kind of thing, I think that's overplayed. I think I love E3. I think I've been to 3 E3s in my life, and they've all been very memorable, so I'm excited to be back, and I'm excited for this plan that they've announced so far about the business and consumer days, because that's actually how Tokyo Game Show does it, and I've been to 1 Tokyo Game Show, and it does the exact same thing, where the first 2 days are for industry only, and then the next 2 days are for like general people, general like consumers, and then also like if you still have appointments. And I think it works really well for Tokyo Game Show. I don't know if it's going to work for E3, but I mean, I can't imagine it'd be that much different. So I'm into it.
Natalie, have you ever been to an E3?
Yeah, I went once in 2018 when the Behind Doors demo of Cyberpunk 2077 was at the show. And then 2019, I went away to university. And then 2020 was the pandemic. Right. So I only got to go once. So I don't think I have the nostalgia that people who have the experience of going multiple times have. But I'm curious about it. I definitely want to see what people, specifically journalists who have to, you know, work on the ground, what they will say about the experience, just because I think it is wise for them to separate not only the days, but the halls. So one hall will be dedicated to media and press, and there will be dedicated spaces for people to conduct interviews and meet. And, you know, there's apparently going to be an application that you're going to be able to use in order to, you know, schedule those things. So I'm very curious, cautiously optimistic, but I totally get why some people already booking hotels and flights and whatnot, because it's an exciting time. Everyone kind of wants that physical event to be back. It's, you know, Summer Game Fest, and all these separate conferences are nice and cool to watch from, you know, the comfort of your home, but everyone wants to see each other again. And I just hope they take the necessary safety precautions, since the pandemic is still very much ongoing. And the usage of masks just seemed to be not a thing that people are concerning themselves with in person very much. So I would like to see them have some really good safety measures for that in place.
Yeah, California has become a lawless wasteland. where every day is a fight for survival. To be fair, it was that before the pandemic, but it's just even worse now. Yeah, I find E3 super interesting, right? Because for one, a couple of things to note is that this is being put on by ReadPop, which is the people behind New York Comic Con, PAX, Star Wars Celebration. And so I'm wondering, like, are we going to see more of a like PAX style show, which I do think a lot of people would be excited for. There's a couple of strange things with it, though. One, Jeff Keighley is, as far as we know, not involved. And he was kind of this weird glue that kind of ran a lot of the driving force behind E3 and, you know, like YouTube gaming, stuff like that. And so him being what could essentially be a competitor to E3 is that remains to be seen. But also, so many publications have taken to speaking to their fans directly, not through something like, you know, E3 and stuff like that. And so E3 existing doesn't necessarily mean that it's going to be the E3 you remember, right? It could end up being wildly different. We already know that PlayStation hasn't been at E3 since 2018. Xbox will probably be there just because they've kind of like stuck around with that kind of stuff. But like, is Nintendo? Like, Nintendo had a huge booth every year, but like, it's been a lot of years now. It's been three since, you know, the times change, and maybe they're going to look and be like, hey, we have been able to deliver this news of, you know, we just had a Ubisoft Forward. And so maybe Ubisoft looks and goes, we've been able to deliver this news without paying these like insane convention center costs. So like,
it's expensive.
Why would we suddenly, you know, go backwards in time and go back to that when we've been able to open these channels directly with our audience? Jada, what do you think?
Yeah, no, I really hope that it comes back and does it right. I hope it really captures even half of the magic that we got to experience at E3 prior to the shutdown and all that type of stuff and not having E3 for years. I've gone to like 6 or 7 E3s, and it was so good at the beginning, and I could start to see the tearing at the cracks. Like, it was like, tearing at the seams. I don't know what metaphors are anymore. They're just words. Let's just throw them all together. Right. You know, they're right. See, Natalie's here. She works with words. So that's all I need. Resident wordsmith in the house. But yes, I really hope it comes back and does it meaningful, because it was such a momentous occasion for me. My first E3, getting to go, really feeling like I'm a part of this industry. I'm covering these big events. I'm getting to meet these develop like 15, 20 developers over the course of this week and interview them and learn the most, like learn about them, about their game, and arguably one of the most like purest forms, because you're literally talking to the creative directors, you're talking to the designers, you're talking to these people like one-to-one. And yes, there is some jargon and publicity stuff that they're going to talk about in Rosie's show, but like, you get to see some of these games at their earliest point that they're ready to be shown, and you get to form just such a unique opinion based on how that resonates with you on that first time playing it, being one of the first, you know, couple thousand people to play this game potentially. So like, I'm really excited for it. I hope they do it right. I really like the idea of the splitting the days, because, you know, from my first E3, I want to say it was 2013 or 2014. I used to have like 15, 20 minute lines to wait for if I was waiting for a game, right, which isn't bad at all for E3 with how many games and how many people were there. But like, going to all the way to 2019, the last year I went, it was just, I'd be waiting like an hour and a half to play a game. I think I waited like whatever year Star Fox Zero was there, I waited like 75 minutes to play that terrible game.
That's a long time to wait.
It's a long time. Yes,
Disney, and I love lines.
Exactly, and I love Star Fox. I love Nintendo stuff. I also, you know, to your point, Mark, about booths, I think we will see Nintendo come back with their booths. I think that is one of their like one of their joys. I think they really love bringing people in and showcasing these big things, making their games larger than life. Nintendo is all about surprising and delighting their fans, and I think their booths is a way for them to really connect with their audience and their community and do that. So I really do think that we will see Nintendo come back with Microsoft. Sony, I don't know though. Like, I feel like Sony is really getting into its own cadence of doing its own thing. I think they may do big, like, marquee events when they have like a bunch of blockbusters that are going to drop in the next like 6 months, 6 to 8 months after E3. They may show up and do like a one-off thing, but I don't think we'll see them return to, you know, rivaling booths with Microsoft and Nintendo. I don't think we'll see that.
Yeah, I've told the story before here on the show, but it's like, one of the main things I miss from E3 is like being with all of your coworkers and friends and stuff like that, and being able to like all work towards this common goal. And it's like this really like, you know, kind of tiring, but like fun week of where everybody just has this common thing where like, it seems like everything else goes by the wayside. Everybody's just focused on E3. So I desperately want those times to come back. And I think we'll get there. And then what you said about, you know, being able to like demo games with like developers and stuff like that. You know, the first time I played Mario Odyssey was a book behind closed doors demo. And I played it with Reggie Fils-Aimé, kind of like explaining supposed to be doing in the game and stuff like that. And it's like, man, I really miss stuff like that. I went to an event a few weeks ago for Mario plus Rabbids Sparks of Hope, and I was with a developer, and I wasn't like super cheeky about it, but I was just like, hey, what did you do on the game? And I expected him to just be like, I made the coin sounds or whatever, which is, I'm sure that's an important job, but I wanted to know what he worked on specifically for the game. He's like, oh, I'm the game director. And I was like, oh, I've been hanging out with the game director for the past 3 hours while he's like, I'm asking him like the worst questions ever. Just like, so why does Rabid Peach look like that? He's like, that's how I that's well. But yeah, I think we can all agree E3 is a good time. If they nail it, awesome. I hope it's what people want it to be and what that vision that they have in their head. But you know, everyone just has to remember that it's been years since there's been a traditional E3. This is being ran by a different company where a lot of, you know, so I want people to manage their expectations. If it's awesome, I super want that, but it could be bad.
It could.
I'm taking a pessimistic approach to E3 this year.
I'll be the optimism that balances you. That's just the way it works. It's our dynamic.
Perfect. We're almost out of time, if you can believe it. It doesn't feel like it's been 48 minutes. It feels like it's been an eternity.
Yeah, man. It's right here.
That's every time I have to have a conversation with Mark, so it's fine.
Every time me and Jada are on a call together, I'm like, you just do all this work and you look and you're like, it's been 3 minutes? No way.
Just like, Mark, quit talking about the forest. I've heard all your stories about the forest already. Just let it.
Oh, you haven't heard them all. Yeah. Next week is just going to be a forest extravaganza. You also love the forest. Oh, it's so good, Natalie. Oh, no. Finally. Here we go. No.
I got to go. I have to leave.
We're jumping forward to 2023. The most anticipated game.
I did not speak whatsoever. You heard the forest? I said forest. Lawrence.
Nice. She meant an actual forest. She likes
I said my name.
She likes hiking. She likes going hiking, you know. Yeah. Okay, makes sense.
You should change your name to Natalie Forest. That would be amazing. Yeah. Just an homage to End Night. I'm so glad there's another Forest fan, because every time I bring it up, everyone's like, yeah, there's this game called The Forest. Cool. It's a good game, guys. Natalie, how much have you played The Forest?
Yeah. Also The Forest, though.
Right? I'm like, we were on Game Scoop last week, and Damon's going over of all the exciting 2023 games. I'm like, you forgot Sons of the Forest, which is
arguably going to be the best. You forgot a very pivotal one. Yeah. Oh, my goodness. No, I share the enthusiasm, but I won't talk about it to spare Jada and my.
Damn it. Jada, once again.
I feel the peer pressure from them. Like, Natalie, don't go forward.
It's just more of like, we just don't like to feed Mark. That's the thing.
Yeah. She just doesn't like me to be happy.
I mean, you're gonna live a long, healthy life. So, but I didn't say it's gonna be a happy one. So
I gotta pace myself. Well, apparently not, because Sons of the Forest is never coming out. That's the carrot on the stick right now, and we're just never gonna get there. No, I believe in them. They're good guys over there. Okay, well, that is going to do it for our show this week. Natalie, one more time, let's get a plug of all where people can find you.
Yeah, you can find me at Hartimecia. That's Hart, I-M-E-C-I-A on Twitter. That's really where I'm at, just shitposting and whatnot.
Cool. Does anybody have anything they want to plug before we take off for the week? Just throwing it out there. We don't normally. That's fine.
There's a couple. I've got a couple community articles that are up and live right now. We've got there's one of them. It's about which video game classic would you like to see make a comeback? That one's live right now. And then also a what's more important to you, the developer or the publisher article. So come and share your thoughts in either of those on IGN.com.
Great. All right, well, that's going to do it for us this week. We will be back next week. Next week's going to be a fun episode, and we do have a little bit of news that I'm not going to share this week, but we'll share it next week. But thank you guys so much for joining me, especially Natalie. Thank you so much for jumping on with us. And please, everybody, go follow her. You can also follow me on Twitter at @Mark_Medina. You can follow Jada at @_Jada. No, I always
Jada underscore Rena. I know, Jada, you're a terrible person. Rena. He just doesn't want me to get followers. He doesn't want me to get followers. He doesn't want me to get too powerful.
Still mad about the prognosis that you gave.
Yeah. I'm still dealing with the shock. And then Matt, people can find you at @LawOfTD.
Yes.
Law of touchdowns.
Okay. I was just Law of touchdowns. Sure.
Biggest football fan on the show. But that's gonna do it for us this week. We will see you guys next week at the normal Tuesday, the new normal Tuesday time. But until then. I hope you're doing well. I hope you're staying safe and beyond.
Beyond.
Nice.
Your chance. Our best shot. You keep her alive. And you set everything right.